we are a social networking, socializing platform. You know, we encourage young people like you guys to know more about the world, right? You know a lot about your textbooks, you know, your biology, your economics and all that. But you know, outside academia, outside classrooms, you know, you need to know a lot about the real world. You know, things that you never learn in classroom, you learn here. So that one day when you do get out of the campus and get into the real world, you're well prepared, well equipped, you know, to do what you're supposed to do. Okay, so academia, I'm telling you guys, trust me, is only one tiny facet of your life. Okay, you only learn about 9% right now. You still 91% to fill up. And this is the reason why I found Small Talk Circles in 2011. And, you know, I mean, I don't have a lot of money, but I actually put in 1 million of my hard-earned savings to start this thing. And subsequently, I had a lot of multinational companies come in to help me to finance this program. And this year, we have a very, a very special family. And I'm going to introduce you to them in a minute. They would actually put up some money to support me so that we could have, you know, Small Talk Circles every month from September to June, okay, to coincide with the school calendar. Now, it's a very busy program tonight. I'm going to just want to kickstart this thing with a funny, funny slide. I think women are foolish to pretend they are equal to men. Uh-oh, now when you read the first sentence, you think this guy is a male chauvinist pig, right? But then you read on, they are far superior and always have been. So girls are actually smarter than men. Whatever you give a woman, she would make better, greater. If you give her sperm, I hope you guys are 18 and above here tonight, huh? Anybody 18 and under, please get out of the room here. If you give her sperm, she will give you a baby. If you give her a house, she will give you a home. Well, that makes sense. If you give her groceries, she will cook you a meal. That also makes sense too, right? Ah, okay. Christmas, right? You have a chicken here with a you know, turkey, right? So, Merry Christmas, and the turkey said, what? Actually, it's not three question marks. It's a word that I don't think I can show here tonight, right? Starting with F, you know what that word is. So the turkey is not very happy about Christmas, isn't it, you know? So the chicken is getting a little bit cocky, if you want. Merry Christmas, turkey, and turkey said, no. F, stop. All right, so this is it. I'm not gonna say anything more, you know? Busy program tonight. So at Small Talk Circles, you know, we encourage you to use the English language because it's still, you know, really important, isn't it? It's a world business language, and you know, until one day Chinese becomes a world language, then we don't need English. But right now, I mean, we do need it, we do use it. And we also want you to learn about the world, as I said earlier, about things that you never learned in the classroom. And ultimately, you know, when you do step out, you know, you'll be real smart. Companies, you know, want to rush in to hire you and then promote you. So this is why we're here tonight. And we have a monthly cocktail reception like this one every single month, okay? And you're gonna get the program from your respective university about the date, time, and venue. So please, this is not the only a party that we have once a year. And obviously we do have a party like this once a year. But we do have a monthly cocktail reception, non-alcoholic reception, by the way, once a month. So please do come. And every month, you know, we invite, you know, important people, or people, you know, called thought leaders. They're very special, right? We invite them to come and speak to us. Okay, now, so tonight, obviously, we have the Honorable Mr. Lam Wun Gong. He doesn't need introduction. You know, he has been with the government for over 40 years. You know, doing various things, you know, touring different departments, divisions, and all that. And most recently, he's the convener of the Hong Kong Executive Council. So without further ado, and he's going to have something very strange. Okay, no, maybe I shouldn't say that. I don't want to, you know, steal your thunder. But, you know, already I said that, you know, the cat is out of the bag, sorry. He's going to have something very funny to show you. Okay? Let's give Mr. Lamb a big round of applause.
I'm going to speak to an audience of youths, largely, anyway. So that's why I've chosen this topic, what is a youth? Now you might be wondering what it's all about. Okay, so just follow. Now, obviously I can only speak from my experience, and that was as a youth some 40 years ago, and the circumstances were very, very different.
You're still very young, Mr.
But, I wouldn't say that, but anyway, thank you. But, although the objective circumstances are different, I believe there are something very universal about youth, whether you are Chinese or Europeans or born in the 50s or born in the 90s. I do believe that as a youth, it's a time for study, of course, for the books, but also a time for love. Basically, it's about study, it's about love. The two are not mutually exclusive, and sometimes they actually complement each other, but always your parents will always tell you, you'll forget about the love and get on with the books. That is serious advice, out of experience. But sometimes, you know, things do happen naturally, okay? I think this is universal. As a youth, I used to be furious from time to time. Furious about what? Furious about my parents. Furious about the schools or colleges. Furious about my professors who give me a D. Furious about my girlfriends who dump me after two, you know, dinners or lunches. Furious about the world. Furious about the government. I mean, as a youth, because when we begin, we always take a rather simplistic view of the world and judge the world from likes and dislikes. And sometimes we are, for those of you who can't see, try to see it. Sometimes we are depressed. For me, when I was 20, I felt that I was often very depressed. But life has to go on, okay? I'm sure you do that, do you?
Yes.
Right. If you don't, then I would be more surprised, and you are not probably not a typical youth. But it's no use shouting, because one day, perhaps next year, perhaps even now, for those of you graduating now, and perhaps a few years later, you suddenly find that the world is yours. You have to face it, whether you like it or not. The responsibility falls on your shoulder sooner than you think. 40 years ago, some 40 years ago, when I jumped into the real world of adults and work and politics, I must say I was totally unprepared. In those times, universities don't have counseling. They just dump you when you graduate, and you, there you are, you know, sink or swim, it's on your own, okay? And you have to be brave, because there's no choice, you have to face it. So courage, whether you have it or not, has to be there. Because you're just like the penguin, you have to jump into the sea, okay? Thousands of years ago, the Greeks, for those of you who like to read ancient literature or history, the Greeks are perhaps the wisest men or women in the ancient world. But even the Greeks, when they face uncertainties, they go for the gods. And this is a very famous temple of Apollo. They go to the gods and ask, what should I do, my god? And the god gave them, at Delphi anyway, gave them a very clever answer. Know thyself. They said, know yourself. And Aristotle, again, another famous Greek philosopher, he also said, knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom. But as you can see from this cartoon, knowing yourself is damn difficult. you have to take your hat off and face yourself. Okay? Face yourself is the most difficult part. Even as a 65-year-old man, facing yourself is the most difficult part of adulthood, of trying to face the world. Before you can face the world, you've got to face yourself. Okay? Your own weaknesses, your own actually also potential and capabilities. When I first graduated from the university, although in those times being a university graduate was a very sort of, how should I put it, prestigious thing. You know, you never need to worry about a job because a lot of jobs will be waiting for you. Because in those times there were so few graduates. But still, the adult world is full of risks, and you feel that the first adult that you talk to, they, you know, he or she is so much above you intellectually, etc. You're so frightened, and you feel that, my God, I'm too stupid. But actually, this book, which actually only came out last year, called The Peak, Secrets from the New Science of Expertise, it studied a lot of human experiences, and the conclusion is that there is no such thing as predefined ability. Whatever you study, whatever grade you are, whatever exam results you get, don't worry about it, because they do not represent you. Potential is an expandable vessel shaped by the various things we do throughout our lives. Throughout our lives, you know, these are the key words, throughout our lives, not just at the beginning. And forget about those win at the Hei Pao Xin, those nonsense, okay? Hei Pao Xin is just the beginning. When you go to the end, it's what you do throughout your lives is the most important thing. And the human brain, the human potential, is far more powerful than we ourselves ever realize. And we can take control of our own lives. Okay, so much for the academic study, which is quite boring. Face yourself, okay? So the first question you always ask yourself, what do you want to be? What do you want to do? Okay? I'm not sure if you ask yourself this question too often, but even if you do, it's very difficult to answer, isn't it? What do you want to do? At 20, 21, 22, I really didn't know what do I want to do, okay? But categorizing it, you know, some people, the idealists would say, you know, I face the world, okay? I camped 79 nights out in Emerald Cave, and I face this damn government, okay? I face them down, you know, that's the courage. Is that what you want to do? Or perhaps let's be more modest. Just try to say to yourself, can I make a difference to this world? If you say this is a damn world, make it less damn, okay? If you say this is a good world, make it better. Just try to make a little difference, can we? So whatever you say you want to be, you need to prepare yourself for it. So what do you need to be? Again, I have to categorize it, simplifying it a bit. And I think the first thing is always aim high, okay? You always achieve low. Aim high, of course, sometimes you can over-aim, but you can always adjust yourself, all right? And this is the second thing, and perhaps even more important, because no matter how high you aim, if you don't work hard for it, forget it, you'll never be there. And you have to be very, very, very hard working. I didn't get lucky until I started working 90 hours a week. In this very international bestseller called The Outliers, I actually recommend you read it, it's very easy reading. You know, this author said, the people at the very top don't work just harder, or even much harder, they work much, much, much harder, just reinforcing the message. And Malcolm Gladwell, the author of the Outlier book, the bestseller, in one of the chapters, he quoted a rather interesting rule. He called it the 10,000 hour rule. But put it in a nutshell, he said, if you invest 10,000 hours in the thing, in doing one thing that you think you're good at, and if you get a very good coach, or good professor, or good mentor, and you spend that 10,000 hours, you may not be Bill Gates, you may not be the Beatles, but even if you get half or even one quarter of what they have achieved, you are there, okay? Actually, Bruce Lee said something very similar. He said, I fear not the man who has practiced 10,000 kicks once, but I fear those who have practiced one kick for 10,000 times, okay? What does 10 hours mean? Okay, let's translate it into something real concrete. If you work 8 hours a day, reasonable enough, huh? 8 hours a day, easy, isn't it? And you take 2 weeks off in a year as holiday, okay? Reasonable, isn't it? Hmm? And you work on that schedule for 5 years, you get 10,000 hours, all right? So let's see, let's look at some Hong Kong examples. See if the 10,000 hour rules work. Who doesn't know Rex Cho here? Don't tell me you don't know him. Okay, you're not from Hong Kong, maybe you don't know him. He's our champion boxer. He's now ranked, I think, in his weight, he's number three in the world, okay? He's going to challenge the champion in that weight, you know, rank, I think in a few months time. He has won in the ring for 20 consecutive matches, never been beaten, okay? And he started off as somebody who was not interested in any box, who just, in Cantonese, we call him hey. You know, he just spent most of his time working on his computer games and things like that. And suddenly one day, he changed and fell in love with boxing. He was boxing as an amateur, and he turned professional in 2011. Okay? 4 years later, he was signed by Top Rank. Now, Top Rank is a top boxing club in the world. They only sign top boxers. They only sign those who can fight for the championship in due course. So they signed him last year. That was the reaching top rank in the world, okay? So what? 4 years. He only spent 4 years, okay? So it seems that the 10,000 hours rule really has some merits. So the second point you remember about working hard is follow the 10,000 hour rule. And you may not know what you're good at, and it's a very simple rule of thumb to remember. Whatever you are studying now, unless you really hate it, then you better change your subject. If you don't, if you like what you're studying, then work hard on what you're studying. 4 years of university plus a year or two of postgraduate, and you are there, then you'll be expert at what you're studying. You see, if you work 10 hours a day, you'll be there earlier. If you work just 2 hours a day and hey, for most of the time, then you will take forever to reach a 10 or never reach a 10-hour rule. Now, other than being very hardworking, you've got to have this sense of curiosity, wondering what's around you. If you don't have curiosity, then it's very difficult to keep yourself working hard. All right? Because you don't care about what's going on around you in the real world, then it's very, very difficult. You've got to have curiosity, all right? And also in the real world, don't be single-minded. Be open-minded, because the real world is real complex. Diversity is civilization's driving force. People are different, so you've got to respect diversity and be open-minded about it. You've also got to have some sense of proportion. When people tell you do this, do that, you've got to have a sense of proportion, and don't overestimate yourself, don't underestimate yourself, be common sense. If you blow your own balloon like this, you can never fly, okay? And after being very hardworking, after being curious, you've got to have imagination, okay? You've got to be creative. And I really love this cartoon. Why did the dinosaurs run extinct? They missed the boat. They missed Noah's Ark. Look at all these faces. How many of you have not used all of them? Huh? Get out of the room if you have not used all of them. Huh? In the 21st century, they are the people. Why do everyone use them? From 6-year-old to 60-year-olds, why? How? Because even 60-year-olds can use WhatsApp in 5 minutes. That's what creativity is about. It's not about rocket science. It's really about making sense of life, making sense of purpose of life, making sense of getting people to live their lives easier, simpler. So how can I become creative? When we talk about creativity, we always think, oh, it's something, you know, out there, the stuff out there. Oh, pretty elusive. Maybe one day the bulb will click and there we are. But one man said this is not the case, and he's the, perhaps the most creative man on earth, but he died young too. Steve Jobs, okay? He has so many fans around the world that it's hard to find another one for the 21st century, at least up to now. I do recommend that you go to YouTube and listen to his Stanford commencement speech made some 10 years ago, okay? Well, there he talked about creativity. There he talked about his life experience. There he talked about creativity is actually from the stuff already inside your skull, all right? It has to be in there. If it's not in there, then you won't be creative. If all the dots are in there, you've got to connect them. That's why it's called connecting the dots. But if it's all empty in there, then there are no dots to connect. So how do you fill the brain with dots that are useful, that can be connected? Wow, pretty old style. It's called reading. Okay? We read a lot of stuff, not just the courses you study. Read things that you are interested in, read things that you're curious about, read things that you don't understand, you want to know why. Go and read. It's now so much easier to read. In my days, I got to go to the library, and the books I wanted to find disappeared because some people took it away for months and never returned. Now you can go to Google or go to the e-books, and you can read a lot all the time. You can read. But life is short. What do you want to read? Okay, if you just stuff your brain with hamburgers, then you come out with hamburgers. So what do you do? What do you do? Other than reading, you've got to think proactively. Sometimes we call it imagine, okay? Imagination. Because taking in the stuff is one thing. Organizing them, connecting your dots is quite another. And the more you practice it, the more creative you become, all right? Okay, I quote you one real life example, all right? Those of you who are business students would certainly know what globalization means. When people talk about globalization, most of the people that you know talk to would think that globalization started from the digital age, when IT began to be applicable. Yes, IT helps a lot, but no, globalization started at globalization, I mean globalization in trade, okay? Started much earlier, 20 years earlier at least. When did it start? It started off with containerization, when products got past oceans from one continent to another. Real cheap products get passed by all these vessels because the freight charge is so cheap that even very cheap products could be, you know, put on the board the ship and sent off to the other continents, and trade boomed as a result. For those of you who could remember pre-1960s, the cargo ships looked like this. Okay? You never see this anymore. And loading and unloading was really, you know, a hassle, a big hassle. Typically, it took 8 days to fully load a cargo ship, because other than putting the cargo on board the ship, inside the cabin, you've got to organize everything by hand. So you've got to wait for 8 days to load, and another 8 days to unload at the other ports. Total more than 2 weeks. And one guy called Malcolm McLean, he was actually we now call it logistics, but in those days he was a truck driver, you know. He was driving all these goods to the docks, and sit there, wait for his goods to be taken off and put on board the ship. And he waited and waited and waited, and he got so bored. One day, he think, bloody hell, I mean, this is a bloody waste of time. Waste a lot of money, waste a lot of, my time is money. Why can't we do it faster? So he started to connect the dots. He started to think, why can't we organize it? Put them into smaller boxes, and then put them into standard boxes, and then put the standard boxes onto standard ships, and the standard ships get loaded and unloaded on standard docks with all these facilities. That's the beginning of containerization. How did he think about it? Because he got the dots. Yeah, that was his first container truck, okay? And he bought from the military and unused cargo ship and turned it into the first cargo ship on Earth called Ideal X. That was in the 1950s. And all of a sudden, loading free charge dropped from what used to be $5.9 per ton to less than 20 cents per ton, a drop of 97% because of A, all the time saved, and B, it's much safer. Nobody could steal it. So the insurance charge or the loss in goods were much less. So everything suddenly took a different turn, and what followed was trade exploded. And the rest is history, okay? That's why I say globalization started much earlier than the IT revolution. But how did he connect the dots? These are the modern container ships. When he was waiting at the docks, he never joined the army. No, that was after the war. But he never joined the army. But he loaded and unloaded for the army, because in those days, America, United States have got to ship a lot of armaments, food, and a lot of these ammunition, etc., got to be transported safely and hidden in secrecy and shipped as fast as they can. So they put them into boxes, okay? So that all these gun shells won't roll around in the boat and explode themselves, okay? So he got it in his brain already. He got his thoughts there, and he just connected them and turn it into a revolution. He died some 16 years ago, not a very rich man. He made a lot of money, but he didn't make too much money. So, I talked about imagination. For those of you who believe in the evolution theory, we human beings have actually come a long way. You believe in the biologists, it took some 5 billion years, forget about billion now. It's just a long, 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 long time for us to evolve from a single cell to, you know, what we are like here in this room. And we are very, very, very different from the animal that is closest to us. The chimpanzees and the gorillas, etc., they are our closest possible relative. But we are so different because of what? Because we are the only species on Earth that can imagine, that can think proactively rather than just respond to circumstances. This skull that you see here down on the left-hand corner is what we call Lucy. It was discovered in Ethiopia of Africa in the early 1970s, and when the archaeologists were digging in the camp, their radio was playing a Beatles song called Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. And that's why later they call this historic find, they call her Lucy. And actually it was a her, after DNA analysis, it was a her. And she probably looked like that in the middle, okay? And we are, if you believe in it, we are all her descendants. Now she must have been imaginative as well, huh? So, 2 million years ago, could she imagine that we can fly, not only fly, but we can float in space? If you come to think of it, this is a remarkable, brilliant achievement of human beings, all because we can think, and think proactively, and imagine, and be creative, and of course, we all work very hard for it. So that more or less concludes what I said tonight, except I want to leave you with this particular piece to think about, okay? So this guy is picking up the phone and heard, thank you for calling Creative Business Seminars. If you'd like to become a more creative problem solver, press 1 without touching any part of your telephone. Okay, I leave you with this quiz and try to figure out how you're going to do it. Thank you very much.
Now, I just have one family to thank tonight, and I just want Catherine and Pecker Wong to come out with Isaac. Please. Please thank you. A big round of applause. Now, they're the title sponsor this year for Small Talk Circle. The Wong family is so generous, you know, and oh, thank you. And they have the heart of gold. Very wealthy family, obviously, and they put up some money to help me out with this small talk circle.
Oh, yes, if only more.